parade is from noon until 2 p.m., starting in downtown Petaluma. Free family fun will happen all day starting at 10 a.m. Call 707-762-9348 for more details. On May 3rd, SL Cannes film series presents a free screening of Motherhood Manifesto, a film about what happens to working mothers and their families in America. The film starts at 7 p.m. at Zocalo Coffee House at 645 Bancroft Avenue in San Leandro. Go to www.slcan.org for details. A grand march for unconditional amnesty for all undocumented workers will be held on Tuesday, May 1st. The event starts at noon at Dolores Park in San Francisco, followed by a march to Civic Center at 1 p.m. For more information, call 415-933-3955. The community calendar is produced by members of the KPFA Apprenticeship Program. Send your listing at least 3 weeks in advance to KPFA Box 51, 1929 Martin Luther King Jr. Way in Berkeley, California, 94704. Fax them to 510-848-3812 or email us at calendar@kpfa.org. Attention to the community calendar. Tell us if your event is wheelchair accessible. To hear this calendar again, call 510-848-6767 extension 621. The calendar is also online at kpfa.org.
You are listening to KPFN, KPFB in Berkeley, KFCF in Fresno, and online at www.kpfa.org. The time is 7:01 now. Stay tuned for Apex Express.
Apex Express, Asian Pacific Expression.
Cultural coverage,
music and calendar,
new visions and voices,
coming to you with an Asian Pacific Islander point of view.
It's time to get on board the Apex Express. Hello, hello, my name is G and with me is Miss Maya. It is a beautiful night here in Berkeley, California. Tonight we are going to hear about Veterans Resistance Movements from a Chinese-American veteran. He'll also be updating us about Lieutenant Aaron Watada's situation. And we'll also learn about the great needs found in the Laotian community. And we're also going to learn about a scandal within that community as well. But first, we are also going to have some music with co-host Maya here. What's up with that?
Yes, yes. Actually, tonight, this artist by the name of Cornelius, a Japanese electronic artist, is going to be playing at Bimbo's tonight. So if you're in San Francisco, hit that up at 8 o'clock tonight. And this track is called Drop. It's a Kings of Convenience track remixed by Cornelius, a.k.a. Keigo. Last name? Oyamada. Check him out.
segue into some of the music that a friend of ours did. It's actually music, a mixture of Southeast Asian music with some hip-hop beats, as you all might have guessed a little bit. Because next up we are going to talk about the Southeast Asian community. The people of Laos are among the most diverse of the Southeast Asian refugees who came to this country right after the war in that area of the world. And they constitute Lowland Lao, Khmer, Hmong, Mien, and Thai Dom. And folks in these countries, and rather in Laos, were farmers and soldiers during the war in Vietnam and in Southeast Asia. And so coming to this country, many Laotians still struggle to survive. And here with us now are two folks from the Laotian community. We have Sari Tapaporn, and we also have Peng. And Peng is a researcher, and Sari is really a community activist. And the first thing we do want to talk about is just some of the needs in the Laotian American community. And then we're going to get right into a scandal that's sort of surrounding a very established Laotian community organization that provides this service. But I do want to get into the background first of what are some of the major needs of the Laotian American community. And I guess maybe I can ask either one of you to start. Maybe, Sari, if you'd like to start off this conversation.
Yeah, thank you for giving us the opportunity to come and make a presentation or share some of our background of need in the Laotian community in San Francisco Bay Area. As you indicated earlier, that Laotian is really diverse. In the Bay Area, we have several different major groups. For example, the Lowland Lao, the Khmer, the Mien, the Thai Dom, and the Lu. These four are the major groups that living in the San Francisco Bay Area. Even though we came from the same country, but our historical background are different. For example, the Khmer and the Mien, the Hmong, are coming from the highland area of Laos. And many of them during the war served as a soldier and working for the Lao government with the previous regime. And when the political landscape changed in Laos, that forced many of us to leave Laos and came to Thailand seeking for the freedom or a new opportunity. Eventually, we came to this country with limited education or knowledge or skill how to adjust to this country. And in general, we have, in terms of need, we do have a similar need among the different ethnic groups, mainly the need in terms of how to get a job, how to learn the language and vocational skill, how to survive in the very complex society of this country, especially in the Bay Area. And I also would like to ask Pang Tomoli to elaborate some more about the need of the our Laotian community.
Yeah, hello. My name is Pang Tomoli, and while I do work as a research assistant at Prevention Research Center here in Berkeley, I am here really as a community activist, part of the Laotian Committee for Community Justice. And I have been in the community for a long time, and I have worked in community organizing. I have done community organizing part of it. I have done the service providers part of it. And I could clearly say that some of the major needs in our Laotian community right now includes senior services. We have many seniors who are just left out in isolation because their children are at work and they and their grandchildren at school, and they don't have the necessary language skills to speak and to and socialize with their neighbors. So that's one part of our community population that really needs some services. The others include youth services, like after school program, in particularly tutoring and sports, just to keep them out of trouble. Affordable housing is definitely a need, and particularly now that many homes are going into foreclosure. I believe it was 2004. I'm not quite sure if that's the right year. But APEN did a survey in our community and found out that about 80% of the Laotian rent and affordable housing is the issue, and that's something that the community definitely need to address.
Oh, Peng,
yes?
I was wondering if I can ask you, mm-hmm. Ansari, something, because there are so many different Laotian groups
right.
within the broader, within the Laotian community. There's
right.
like four or five or six.
Yes.
Do folks actually see themselves as one people once they're in the United States, or they kind of, stick to their own specific ethnic group, like Khmer, stay with Khmer, and Mien with Mien, et cetera? Or people kind of see themselves, you know, as one united group in this country when they have to get, you know, something done?
I think it depends on when you're asking the question. If you're asking questions, if there's many ethnic groups sitting together and you're asking, well, who are you or what ethnic group you're from, they'll tell you that they're either Mien, Khmer, Hmong, or Lowland Lao. But in general, when we talk to the mainstream, is Laotian, and I believe that the only group that have really distinguished themselves from being identified as Laotian are the Hmong. The rest of us have really just say that we're Laotian, or Lao Khmer, or Lao Mien, or things, or something of that nature.
Yeah, if I may add, the reality is there in terms of the social belonging to each different ethnic group. For example, the Khmer tend to closely associate with, among their own ethnic community. The same thing happened to other ethnic, like Thai Dam, like Mien. Even among Mien community, there's two different major groups, a Christian group and non-Christian group.
Mm-hmm.
Same thing in the Lowland Lao, in other Khmer or Thai Dam ethnic group. However, when we're talking about the common interest, we do come together. We don't really have a major conflict or anything like that.
Okay.
I'm talking about it at the community level,
right.
At the ordinary people level.
Yeah, we're going to get into that a little bit about a particular service organization that's at the center of controversy within the community. We're going to take a little bit of a music break, and then we're going to come right back here on Apex Express. And we're on 94.1 FM KPFA and KPFB in Berkeley and KFCF in Fresno, and online at www.kpfa.org. And the time is 7:14, and we'll be back in just a bit. music mix was DJ Crush, and we're back with some music by Siren Saran. And he is a student of DJ Fadrix, and he contributed this music, which is a mix of Cambodian music and some beats. We're on here at KPFA in Berkeley, California, with Peng and Sari Tapaporn, and they are talking with us here on Apex Express about the Laotian community, which has a lot of great needs. Also, there are a lot of services that need to be met. And among one of the issues that's happening now within the Laotian community is the issue of the Laotian community development, Laotian Community Family Development Corporation. Is that right?
Lao Family Community Development.
And I've been getting some information not only from them, but from Mr. Tapaporn here. And essentially, from what I gather, is that there's been allegations of nepotism at the Lao Family Community Development. Now, this community development organization has been around for quite a while, and it served the community fairly well, from what I understand, until now, where this there's the issue of people putting their friends and really their family on the board and, I guess, an executive director positions. Now, I'm going to jump to something. From what I understand in reading all the literature, it's that at the Lao Family Community Development, the main issue, it seems, is that the outgoing executive director, Mr. Chow San Chow, he has gotten a position now of CEO, which I guess was created. And even though he stepped down from being the director, he is now CEO, and he's getting a salary of about $7,000 a month. And his daughter, Kathy Chow Rothberg, is now the new executive director of the same organization, Lao Family Community Development Incorporated. Now, this seems to be the two main concerns. Is that correct? And maybe one of you guys can elaborate on this a little bit more and why it's creating so much controversy, if this has been around for a long time and, you know, if it's been serving the community fairly well. How did this blow up?
Yeah, I want to take the opportunity to say that this organization was founded back in 1980, and by the leader of a multi-ethnic community living in the Bay Area. At that time, there's many Hmong, Mien, Khmu, Thai Dam, and other. I'm talking about back in 1980. The 1984 was the first year that the organization received funding, really small funding. And the board or the leader who founded the organization asked Mr. Chow Chan to take the position as executive director. Ever since, he served as an executive director for organization until 2005. And there was never ever had any controversy, any unhappiness or anything like that happening. But when, as soon as he announced to step down, and he he issued a job announcement looking for someone to replace him, as he claimed that he had conducted a nationwide search for someone to replace him. At the end of that process, he picked his daughter to replace him. Not only that, instead of stepping down or retire or serving as a advisory or consultant capacity, he created a new position, CEO position, and for himself. That triggered a lot of unhappiness in the Laotian community.
Now, from what I understand, also the community is Kathy Chow said that that, you know, there was a nationwide search and she received the position because of her abilities. Is there a dispute about that, or is this a fair way to do it, or should she just have people just step down?
We have a question about the process. At this point, we don't know how wide the job announcement and how many people had applied for, and who served as a panel that interviewed the candidate, and who's are the on the board and had a meeting and approved her appointment, as well as the creation of this president and CEO position. At this point, we have no idea who are they that they call the board, and we have no idea. We need approved. If there's as a board, if there's as a board meeting, and we need to see the evidence, mm-hmm. we need to see the proof.
I think Peng has something to add on that.
Yeah, I think that the two key position, the two key executive position, is not the only problem. The problem is that the former executive director did not just stop at hiring his own daughter as his successor. He also had his wife as the secretary of the board, also have his daughter-in-law running the San Pablo office, and his son, John Chow, running the Sacramento office. That, to the community, was just too much to bear. In the past, whatever that happened, and people in our community don't like to say much, but when it's that blatant, we believe that we have to do something about it. It's just too much.
Yeah. Now, what I understand is being done about this is that people want the funding to stop, want city funding to stop being given to the Lau Family Community Development, and until this gets resolved. But my question is, if they stop funding for this organization, then won't it hurt services being provided to the community? What would be, you know, how would that resolve itself?
I think that we don't really want funding to stop. We want the family to resign, and we want to keep the organization intact. Now, if the family does not resign, then definitely that's what's going to happen. There has to be investigation, and there has to be some kind of auditing to see, because I mean, all we're asking for is transparency, community involvement, diversity in board and diversity in management. And we have not seen that in the organization, which is the original mission and the original vision of the community leaders who started the organization in the first place. That's all we really want.
Yeah, and my other question is, what's happened now is that has the county stepped in or the city stepped in to help resolve the situation? And maybe if we can kind of wrap this up a little bit. I know there's a lot more information, but what's the situation right now? Is there any progress being made?
Yes, so far we had filed a formal complaint with the City of Oakland, with Alameda County, Contra Costa County, with the state EDD, with the Health and Human Services, I'm talking about at the federal level, as well as with the HUD, and also with the IIS that grant the 501c3 to this organization. We asked them to investigate and to work with us to prove this controversy. If indeed there's a violation of the IIS 501c3 status, we would want to see the IIS suspend the 501c3 status and to force the family to accept the reality. And originally, it's not our intent to see the organization go down. So many people had had spent time, energy, money back in the 1980s. Many of us spent $15 a month paying for contribute to this organization. At the time, there's no money coming in. We rent a small office in Richmond. The board of directors, the founder, contribute $15 a month
So as you can see, this organization is very dear to us. Yeah. We really don't want it to see it go down, but we do need we do need for things to be right in this organization.
Now I have a question. If people want to learn more about what's going on, is there a contact number for folks on your end? I know that Peng or sorry, if you have any information that can be given out, if there's a contact number. I know for the Lao Family Community Development Group, there is they have a website which is www.laofamilynet.org, and so if you guys have a contact number for people who wanna learn more about this.
Yeah, for our group, we form a Laotian Committee for Community Justice. The address is P.O. Box 6127 San Pablo, California 94806. And the phone number is 510-691-9523. Mm-hmm. 691-9523.
Okay, I want to say thank you so much, Peng and Asari, and we hope that this issue gets resolved, because there's so many greater and very, very definitely needy folks in the very broad Laotian community. But we're glad to have you on, and if this gets resolved, then tell us and we'll see what we can say or put it on our calendar of events. And with that in mind, this is Apex Express right here on KPFA 94.1 FM and KPFB in Berkeley, KFCF in Fresno, and online at www.kpfa.org. The time is 7:26, and stay tuned for more music. And we're going to be speaking with Michael Long, who is an Asian American Vietnam veteran, and going to update about Lieutenant Aaron Watada as well. But Maya, we have music coming up that you have selected. And it's all ready to go. You have anything to say about this particular piece we're going to be listening to?
Yeah, well, I don't know whatever happened to this group, but it's called Solstice. It's an electronic crew based out of San Francisco, and they came out in 95. This track is called Tenderly, and that's the classic by Stan Getz, but it's remixed by DJ May Loon of the Solstice, along with, I think, Andy Caldwell. So enjoy.
Caress the trees tenderly. The trembling trees embrace the
The summer music, this is definitely a summery type song, man. Very Stan Getze. You know, with that, I did want to say that this is Apex Express, and we have something that I do want to play. It is about Lieutenant Aaron Watada and some community organizers who went up to his first court-martial earlier this year up in a Seattle area, I think. And I'm going to play this for you, and this is going to kind of be the intro into our next piece featuring an Asian American Vietnam veteran. And in this particular little segment, you'll hear another veteran talk about support for Lieutenant Aaron Watada along with other Asian American supporters here. So we're going to play this for you just in a little bit and go right into our interview with Mike Wong. So hang on. A group of supporters of war resister Lieutenant Aaron Watada held a press conference in front of Berkeley's Civic Center.
Going up to Fort Lewis.
Organized by Asian Pacific Islanders Resist, some members will drive to Fort Lewis and be present at Lieutenant Aaron Watada's court-martial. Grace Shimizu spoke about what they hope to accomplish.
What we want to do is bring the public and the media attention to Aaron's cause, but also to show support to Aaron, that there's thousands and thousands, if not millions of people here in the United States and around the world that really support his courageous stand.
Watada's supporters at the press conference included longtime activist Ying Lee Kelly, who presented Berkeley Mayor Tom Bates.
Berkeley has been in the past a sanctuary city, and I feel very strongly that we are also going to be a sanctuary city for anybody who doesn't want to go.
Councilman Max Anderson also spoke about why he supports Lieutenant Aaron Watada.
Some 35, 40 years ago, I was a 20-year-old Marine in Vietnam. And believe me, I've seen enough there to last me a lifetime. So I understand that Lieutenant Watada's courage, his valiant effort to breathe some life into the Nuremberg principles, we will continue to support efforts to bring this war to an end that you cannot use as an excuse. I was following orders. He had the courage to stand up and confront the Rumsfeld Bush
Rice,
Cheney, cartel of warmongers into the most devastating kinds of conflicts around.
I'm Jenna Hutta reporting for KPFA Radio. And you just heard a little segment that was recorded earlier this year when some folks went up and carpooled it up to give support to Lieutenant Aaron Watada. And with me tonight is another supporter of Lieutenant Aaron Watada. He is Michael Wong, and he is also an Asian American Vietnam veteran. He is also a writer. Some of his writings have appeared in the compilation edited by Maxine Hong Kingston, and he is also active in and involved in a film that talks about veteran war resistance called Sir, No Sir. And during the Vietnam War, Michael Wong opposed going to Vietnam, and for that, he was put in jail and was in exile in Canada for a while. So I want to welcome you to Apex Express, Michael.
Thank you.
Thanks for coming out from San Francisco. I wanted to have you fill in a little bit about your history. I gave a real short background about yourself, and then maybe later on we'll go into a little bit about an update on Lieutenant Aaron Watada's situation.
Okay, basically my history is that I was in the United States Army during the Vietnam War. I was in for a year, got orders for Vietnam. By that time, the My Lai massacre had already occurred. It was already well established that the United States had violated international law and set up the Saigon regime for their own interests, and that it was an illegal and immoral war. I refused orders. I turned myself into the Presidio Stockade. I was facing three charges, each worth 5 years, total 15 years. I was planning to plead guilty to those charges, but instead they released me from the stockade, put me back on Vietnam orders. I deserted. I escaped to Canada. I was there for 5 years, came back after the war, pleaded guilty to long-term AWOL, got an undesirable discharge. I've gone on to be a social worker. I have a master's in social work degree. And I've always been very upfront with my employers about my history. Mm-hmm. And it's never been a problem. In some cases, it's actually been an asset.
You know, being an Asian American Vietnam veteran, I wonder if, you know, I've spoken to Asian American Vietnam veterans, and some of the racism that they faced when they were in Vietnam was really quite stressful. I mean, it was a war waged against Asians, and the way you looked oftentimes made a heck of a lot of difference. And they would go into combat or just before combat and feel like they themselves were seen as the enemy. So as a Chinese American, even though you didn't go to Vietnam, what was your opinion about that war? It was a time when, you know, the issue of race in Asian Americans was very much on the forefront of this war, you know, and the Asian Americans were often the strongest anti-war, you know, folks out there.
Yeah, you know, the whole thrust of imperialism has combine the issues of race, class, gender into kind of one big mix. So you can't really separate them. There was a lot of, you know, the word gook, slophead were used as derogatory terms for Vietnamese. There was that stereotyping going on. It did have effect on some troops, not on others. There were by the time I was in, which was 69, there was a very strong anti-war movement going within the military. And that movement also got caught up with civil rights and, you know, equal rights for all people. So there was this split in the military. There were some troops and some units that were very, very racist and very right-wing, and there were other troops and other units that had gone over to the left and were taking almost the exact opposite tack. Mm-hmm. I happened to be very fortunate in that I was stationed with a unit that happened to be fairly left-wing. I mean, we had a couple of people in our unit who were gay. We supported them. I was lucky not to face discrimination within my particular unit. There were particular occasions when I met somebody who didn't understand about Asian Americans, but they weren't hostile. So it was just kind of the luck of the draw.
You know, you had to run away to Canada. How was that like, leaving this country and then having to come back? What did you face? Well, one of the main things, when you think about that, what strikes you the most?
It was the toughest decision of my life. You know, it's like I knew that when I came out and opposed the war that half the country would condemn me forever. I also knew that the other half would support me. And it was sort of a damned if you do, damned if you don't situation. If you go to Vietnam, there were lots of people that were, you know, accusing you of being a baby killer. If you don't go to Vietnam, there are people accusing you of being a coward. So either way, you get condemned by half the country. Your only choice was what you felt was right and which half the country you would rather be condemned by. We all had to make a choice. I made my choice. It was the most difficult of my life, but, you know, when I look back, I'm glad that I made the choice that I made, because I think that the other choice would have been even worse.
Mm-hmm. Now, you're also involved in Veterans for Peace, is that correct?
Correct.
And looking at the veterans resistance movements back in the war in Vietnam and Southeast Asia versus now, do you think it's the same momentum's there? It's the same kind of issues that people are facing, the resistors, or is it fairly different?
There's a lot of similarities. I would say in terms of its essence, it's more similar than different. During the Vietnam War, GI resistance was huge. There were over 100 underground GI newspapers. There were thousands of GIs marching against the war. Vietnam veterans against the war consisted of thousands of people, and they kept growing throughout the war. There were over 500,000 incidents of desertion, and there were entire units refusing to go into combat. The way it started, however, was with just a tiny handful of GIs who saw through the lies early and came out against the war. And gradually more and more GIs started getting involved and started speaking out and started taking actions. The same thing is happening now. Because you have an all-volunteer army, you tend to have more people who are pro-war in the military, at least at the beginning of the war. But as the war goes on, and as people see the discrepancy between what they're seeing in front of their face on the ground and what the president is saying, more and more soldiers become disillusioned. We already have had dozens of GIs go public in refusing to go to the war and refusing to fight. Many are, there's about 200 in Canada right now. There are over 3,000 calls a month to the GI Rights Hotline, which helps GIs who have problems with the military, who want to get out, who want to refuse orders, who want to avoid going in some way either legal or illegal. So it shows that discontent is growing within the military. And just 2 years ago, Iraq Veterans Against the War started with 7 or 8 GIs. Now they have several hundred GIs, and they're growing all the time. And it's including both active duty GIs, and it's including veterans of Iraq who have gotten out of the Army and come back and are speaking out.
You know, the other question I have is Lieutenant Aaron Watada's situation. Maybe if you can give us a summary of where he is right now, and then I think there's going to be a hearing in May, right?
That's correct. As probably a lot of people know, First Lieutenant Aaron Watada refused orders to Iraq, said that the war is illegal and immoral, and that therefore orders to go to serve in that war are also illegal and immoral. There was a court-martial. It ended up in a mistrial, which was forced by the judge, essentially, and was not the fault of the defendant. So the situation is that if they try him again, it's double jeopardy. The military has refiled charges anyway, and they're claiming that it's not double jeopardy. So this is going to be contested in court. There's going to be pretrial motions in May, the middle of May. And at those pretrial motions, Aaron Watada's legal team will appeal on the basis of double jeopardy and ask that the trial be dismissed, or the charges be dismissed. If their appeal is refused, then it goes to the next higher level, and eventually it goes to civilian court and eventually to the Supreme Court.
Mm-hmm. What do people in his support committee feel right now, the chances of his double jeopardy being accepted? I mean, that they won't try him again.
It's looking like the Army is going to try to push it, which is not really wise for them because their chances of success in the long run are not very great. Double jeopardy is a long-standing principle of American law that has been fairly consistently upheld. And I think even the conservatives would be hesitant to throw that overboard, which they would be doing if they allowed this trial to go forward. So we think we have a pretty good chance, actually. But it may take several levels of appeal to accomplish that.
Have you been in contact with Lieutenant Watada in the last couple of weeks and months at all?
Yes, we've been in contact with him by phone, by email, and in person.
What's he going through? I mean, is he fairly isolated now? What's his spirit like?
Actually, his spirit is very strong. He has a close circle of friends around him. He has some very experienced organizers up in Seattle who are working closely with him that he sees on a regular basis. And he's got a very strong legal team, and he knows that he has a great deal of support all around the country. So he's very strong, he's very calm, he's very balanced. He knows what he's doing, and he's prepared to pay whatever price is necessary to do it.
Mm-hmm. Now, you also are involved in some writing. Maybe you can tell us about that. Maxine Hong Kingston is the editor of this particular book that has people who have been affected by violence or the war. What's your particular writing about, and what's the name of that particular book?
Okay, the book is Veterans of War, Veterans of Peace. The website is wvop.org. It's an anthology of all the writings of the Veterans Writing Group, which has gone on for over 12 years now, facilitated by Maxine Hong Kingston and composed of a group of people that range everywhere from Vietnam combat veterans to war resistors like myself. There's another deserter in there with me. They're peace organizers. They're women who served as nurses or in the Red Cross in Vietnam. We have people from other militaries and other wars, including the Israeli Army. We have somebody from the First Gulf War there, and we have had visits by Iraq veterans. We've also had a session once where some NVA, a North Vietnamese Army and Viet Cong veterans came and met with us as well.
Wow. And there is also another film that you're in. I don't know how long you're in this film, Sir No Sir, right?
Yes, it's called Sir No Sir. It's about the GI anti-war movement during the Vietnam War. I have a very brief part in it where I essentially have the dubious distinction of introducing the May Lai Massacre.
I see. Wow. That and for folks that don't know, maybe the May Lai Massacre was when
An American platoon led by Lieutenant Kelly went into a Vietnamese village, rounded up and slaughtered all of the villagers that they could find, including old men, women, and children. And they ended up killing about 500 people.
500.
And that was when that hit the news. It was a turning point in the public's view of the war in Vietnam. Mm-hmm. It had an effect very similar to the effect that Abu Ghraib has had in this war.
The other thing, too, is that movie, Sir, No Sir, that's going to be shown on May the 7th on the Sundance Channel.
Yes, that's correct. And it's also going to be followed by The Ground Truth, which is a movie about the Iraq War veterans, what they went through. And the last part of the movie features Iraq veterans against the war, speaking about what it was that made them turn against that war. So the two movies together really show the similarities between the experience of soldiers in Vietnam and in Iraq and what it was like being occupiers in a country that didn't want them there.
So now for if people want to get a hold of you or Veterans for Peace, is there a number they can contact or any way to
probably the best thing is
get
to
an update about Lieutenant Aaron Watada?
Yeah, to get updated on Lieutenant Aaron Watada, they should go to thankyoult.org. And to find Veterans for Peace, they can go to veteransforpeace.org. To find Iraq Veterans Against the War, they can find ivaw.org.
Michael, I want to say thank you so much for being here on Apex Express. You've done so much and still continue to keep on doing things. We want to say this is Apex Express, Asian and Pacific Islander programming here on KPFA and KPFB in Berkeley, KFCF in Fresno, and online at www.kpfa.org. Again, thank you, Michael. And my name is Jenna. We're going to go into the calendar after this little music break, and then we'll be right back with some more music. So hang on.
Thank you.
Ask.
Life from day one ain't none but fake reality. Tame the team to play the game of society. So what's the real? Stepping up with your deal, what you feel. Don't leave it hanging, keep it rolling like a wheel. Life from day one ain't none but fake reality. Tame the team to play the game of society. So what's the real? Stepping up with your deal, what you feel. Don't leave it hanging, keep it.
語りのタイトル金銀財宝夢希望のトレジャーハントうまいにまずは自らの心身を解放よコパス的手術期鎮静ゴールドラインとのせ金星その地名星から時間軸の地平線を展望遥か彼方霞むならば点々点What you feel, don't leave it hanging, keep it rolling like a wheel. Life from day one ain't none but fake reality. Team to team, we play the game of society. So what's the real, stepping up with your deal. What you feel, don't leave it hanging, keep it rolling like a wheel. 1歳から20歳を社会育ち与えられた命に授かりしみち感謝するべき親と神 For their love, trust and loyalty 仕込みたっぷりの学校での日々小中高プラン通りうまく設定された人生 like a story もう差し図はゴリゴリ180度回転
You are listening to some music I picked up in Tokyo, Japan Delighted Mint, that's the name of it And Delighted Mint And the track is called Ask. So some really great music is coming out of Japan. Also, this is time for the community calendar. I've been getting a lot of information regarding the Pacific Renaissance Plaza because it is the site of one of the few places for affordable housing in the area of Oakland Chinatown. And as some folks know, Oakland Chinatown is a very, very congested, immigrant-heavy community. And in the 1970s, what occurred was that the city of Oakland signed an agreement with the developer of the Pacific Renaissance Plaza that they would have affordable housing as these more expensive buildings were being built and depleting inexpensive housing. So anyways, there has been negotiations to try and keep affordable housing for some of the tenants in the Pacific Renaissance Plaza, and it's been a site of ongoing negotiations and struggles to try and keep some affordable housing in Oakland Chinatown. So this Saturday, the 28th of April, at the Pacific Renaissance Plaza at 10:30 a.m., there's a commemoration of this struggle, and it's going to be people talking about what's going on with negotiations with the city, and there's also going to be Chinese drumming by the Heigu group. So if people want to know more information, they can go to 650-580-7719. Again, that's 650-580-7719, and you can call, I believe, Eric it is, for more information. Also, there's going to be several plays about a little-known piece of history, and that during World War II, not only Japanese Americans, but some German and Italian Americans were declared enemy aliens by the United States government after Pearl Harbor was bombed, and these German Americans and Italian Americans, along with Japanese and Japanese Peruvians, were put in special internment camps in the United States. Now, this is a little-known piece of history. The Japanese Peruvians were actually in Peru, living there for several a generation or two after Pearl Harbor. The Peruvian government and the United States government forced these took the Japanese out of Peru and put them in basically concentration camps in the United States to be used as prisoners of exchange, possibly. So to learn more about this, on April the 28th, there's going to be a conference called Hidden Stories of World War II, Enemy Alien Restrictions and Internment. That starts at 1 o'clock at the San Mateo Public Library. And that website is www.smplibrary.org, and that's all one word, smplibrary.org. And following that, in that evening, there's going to be 3 one-act plays about each Italian and German, Japanese Americans, each of those three groups. The plays are going to concentrate on what happened to these communities. And that is called Lost Freedom. The whole shebang is called Lost Freedom. And that's at 7:30 at the Little Theater of Hillsdale in Hillsdale, San Mateo. and Little Theater of Hillsdale High in San Mateo. The admission is free, and if you want more information, you can go to www.hillsdalehigh.com. HillsdaleHigh.com. Also, you are listening to some music in the background from Monsoon Wedding. It is a fairly well-known movie by Meera Nair, and the earliest, one of the earliest, most popular directors from India is Satyajit Roy, I believe, Satyajit Ray, excuse me, and he did the film Panth Panjali, which was shown in the 1950s, and it received many film awards. It's about a youth in living in near poverty in Bengal. And this particular film is going to be part of the San Francisco Film Festival, and it's showing Sunday, April the 29th at 5:30 p.m. at the San Francisco Museum of Modern Art. Again, the film is one of the award-winning early Indian films called Panth Panjali. It's also being co-presented by ThirdEye.org, a local, New York and San Francisco-based South Asian film presenting organization. And their website is www.ThirdEye.org, and that's spelled T-H-I-R-D-I.org. And also, there is an exhibit for folks who like more, I would say it's an exhibit about music and festivals. And it's about the Japanese-American Matsuri, which means festival in Japanese. And it has a lot to do with what happened to the Japanese returning to their communities after World War II, and the communities themselves were pretty much devastated after the internment. But Matsuris are times when people do come together, and there's plenty of photos of this at this new exhibit happening in San Francisco with the National Japanese American Historical Society. And then again, that is also this Saturday. A lot of things happening this Saturday. And that is at 1684 Post Street in San Francisco, Japantown. It is free, and following the exhibit opening at 2 p.m., there is going to be a discussion and talk and music by drummer Melody Takada. She plays the Japanese drums, and bassist and shamisen player Tatsuo Aoki. Again, it's all happening at National Japanese American Historical Society, and their number is, their email is njahs@njahs.org. It is free. And I think we're due for some outro music. Maya, what's up next? What interesting thing do you got for us to hear?
Actually, this is a friend that passed this on to me, so thank you. This is an up-and-coming producer out of the UK named Eric Lau. And this track, I believe, is called I Feel Fine, and it's with a female vocalist that he works with named Rahel. So you can check him out on myspace.com/Eric Lau, L-A-U, music. Enjoy.
And stay tuned for the Bonnie Simmons shows as we go out.
I'm not gonna say.